Hi, you're watching Bloomberg Quint. We're days away from Budget 2021. And today we have with us on Bloomberg Quint, our business leader, as well as CII leader, Sanjeev Bajaj. Mr. Bajaj, thanks very much for joining us this afternoon on Bloomberg Quint. Hope you're well and good to see you again.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, let me get started by asking you to gauge where we are in the economic recovery process, Sanjeev. On a scale of 1 to 10, assuming 1 being the lockdown months, the early lockdown months, and 10 being the pre-COVID times, though we were in a slowdown already then, where are we today? Where would you put us?
It's tough to put a number, Menaka, especially because, you know, many sectors are recovering quite well, some are not. I would say overall, and you're right, even pre-COVID, things were slow as an economy. Compared to that, I would say that we are at about 7 on average, but 7 on that slower number. The important thing is that many sectors have started to recover quite well, and they are between 80 and 90% of pre-COVID levels. But there are a few sectors, we know them all, airline, travel, hospitality, and a few others that are suffering a lot more, and they've are also equally responsible for the economy staying a little slow. Also, let's keep in mind that the informal sector, and it's difficult to gauge what's their impact, but we know it impacts everything from consumption to new investment. They got hammered in this period, understandably, and that recovery will take a lot more time.
Okay, if I was to put the same question to you from a slightly different perspective, let's look at the perspective of Bajaj Finance, right? I think in your recently announced earnings, you said in terms of Q3 loan disbursements, B2C, SME, rural B2C, mortgages, these were all at about 80, 81% of last year's disbursement levels. Where is that missing 20%? Because that would give us some insight into which part of the economy is still not feeling the confidence enough.
So first, as you can see in my background, I'm talking today on behalf of CII, but I will answer that question. That is really the bottom 20% of the people that we used to approve in the past. A lot of that is on unsecured loans, and it is also in certain geographies where we see the lockdowns or the impact of the lockdown, let's say the continued impact of the lockdown, and where business is still slow. So that's where the bottom 20% is, but that is also improving now month on month. And hence, when we are looking at this as Bajaj Finance, I think first quarter of the next financial year, we should be back to what things were pre-COVID.
Okay. I also meant to ask, from the point of view of what reading of the economy Bajaj Finance can give us, what does it tell us about consumer confidence, about people's ability to want to spend, borrow and spend, confidence in SME businesses, or even to some extent distress? Because you also borrow in times of distress.
I think that's a great question. And in many ways, for at least certain segments of the economy and consumption, we end up being a reasonably decent barometer to see how things are doing. On the personal consumption side, I believe that most consumers today are at just about pre-COVID levels. What they are not certain about yet is going forward, next 12, 24, 36 months, how will growth take place in their companies? Where will jobs go? And they are hence buying more than what they were buying in the first 6 months of the lockdown, but they are not opening their purses fully. There's another hidden, potential there that a lot of our consumers who are middle class and above in the first 6-8 months of the lockdown have not spent a lot of their money. As long as they get the confidence that their jobs are where they are. And it's not only to do with COVID, it's to do with work from home and what that does to the nature of jobs. A lot of that is changing. It doesn't mean it will change overnight, but it will change in the coming years. So people are a little concerned. But as far as the impact of COVID is concerned, I think on the consumer side, that is well behind them. We have to hence see what the government does, what private sector does to give them confidence to spend more. As far as the SME sector is concerned, I think the government and RBI did a great job with the liquidity support and with the government announcing that it would take the hit on the first set of losses with them. This has basically helped a very large section of MSMEs to stay afloat. Otherwise, they would have gone under. So they are now very much afloat. Their noses are above the water. They are breathing. But we now need to help them with the next stage, which is to grow. And that's where they are looking for signs in the economy. They're looking for what comes in this budget. If that aids them with greater growth, then that will benefit them. Informal economy, we don't deal in that. But as I mentioned to you, I think that's in all kinds of trouble. And that will have its, I mean, that will have to play through and it will have its negative impact.
Okay. So then, therefore, in the context of what you've just described as the current state of the economy, Sanjeev, what is the biggest challenge that this economy is facing in the near term? Would you say it would be boosting consumption? Would you say it would be job recovery? Though there has been some recovery in the last few months from the very high levels of unemployment that we saw about 6 months ago, but there's also been a drop in the labor rate participation. So what do you think the priority ought to be, the one or two priorities ought to be for this budget? And then we'll talk about how do you expect the budget to be able to tackle that?
I would say that this budget should work on a two-pronged manner. The first is, as a typical budget, what's required for the next 12 months, but more importantly, signals of what the government can do and will do for, say, the next 3 years. And let's take each one of them, right? So the first is, you are going to see between 8 to 10% growth in the GDP in the next year, given the base effect of this year. What we would like is for the government to continue some of the benefits to the lower end income segment of this country, so to MSMEs and the lowest end of consumers, continue with the food support to the poor so that, you know, you take care of some of those basics. They're not out of the woods yet. So some of that basic support must come in. Some of the support that the government has given in terms of employee contribution on hiring new people, these were for smaller industries. They were for employees up to 25,000 salaries a month. Increase that to 50,000 so that you get the wheels of the engine running again. So these would be for the short term. But I think our challenge is that after next year's 8 to 10% growth, what happens in FY23 and FY24? We have the time to plan for that and to make sure we have that same growth trajectory and we don't fall down to a 4, 5, 6% growth that many economists are worried. And for that, I think from the government point of view, they will have to stimulate growth for some point of time. Private sector has come back to 80-90% of pre-COVID, but they still sit on some idle capacity because that existed even the earlier year, as we talked about, when the economy was slow. So the government will have to support with investments. And I think investments in infrastructure, on health side, on education, some of these can have a multiplier effect to the economy in coming years. Divestment, because after all, government needs money. You will see some amount of cut in the fiscal deficit because this year was a crazy year. But we hope that the government will look at this as more a three-year roadmap for fiscal deficit to come back within prudent numbers and signal that, continue to support in this interim period. But hopefully over a three-year period, you need less and less support because then the private sector and other engines of the economy will start running.
So you're mostly advocating for whatever additional room the government has to spend, right? Because, I mean, depending on which economists you talk to and which brokerage note you read, we'd have between, discretionary spend of about 2.5 lakh crores to 5 lakh crores, depending on what nominal growth numbers you take, what fiscal deficit projection you take, etc. My point is, you're mostly advocating, efforts in the budget that speak towards medium and longer term stimulus, right? Like infrastructure, healthcare, these things don't show up in 6 months, 8 months. They take 2 years, 3 years, 4 years to show up in terms of any, benefits. You're not suggesting, or you don't expect, for any immediate 6 month, 8 month consumption boost besides the continuation of some of the policies that were put in place through the Atmanirbhar program during the COVID period.
I don't expect, because I don't think they have too much of bandwidth to do that. I do hope that for the sectors that we talked about, which are really doing badly, they get some amount of support over there. But I know that the government is also limited in what they can do. So if at this point of time, they start investments in the medium to long-term initiatives, that helps beyond maintaining what I already talked about. And must pursue very strong divestment. They must look at creating a bank holding structure or whatever other sensible means, so that other than those two, three strategic PSBs, which they would want to hold majority control in, talk about the fact that you will go down below 50 in the rest. That will help improve valuations. So there are many signals that the government can do. Of course, they have to walk the talk after that. But there are many signals that the government can do as well. For example, you know, in China, people talk about projects from signing to production happening in 8 months, in 10 months. Why can't we pick 5 projects at a national level, monitor it there, and see that at least from 0 to 24 months, we can take them to production. So we can tell the world, come to India, this is the place to make for the world. It helps us with our self-reliant or Atmanirbhar India. But more importantly, the world sees that you are able to walk your talk. That's very important now, because that's a huge opportunity for us.
Can I argue, Sanjeev, that, you know, with the PLI scheme or the National Infrastructure Pipeline, the government seems to have made these, sent out these signals earlier as well. The question or the fear right now is that many people believe that any further investment from the private sector will only depend on consumption going up, and therefore the need for some immediate stimulus towards consumption. Now, whether that comes via a personal income tax change, you know, or something else that you may want to suggest, do you think that's that should be a key element of the budget?
So I believe that it could have been one. It could have been one 6 months ago, when things were far worse than where we are today. If it is done today, and again, it goes about, you know, what's the amount that is available to spend. So, and a lot of it are unknowns, because it depends on the divestment target. It depends on assets they can monetize, and not only their willingness, but their ability to be able to do that. Based on that, additional funds that you can get and you can put it to immediate consumption, it will help. But what we have seen in the last 3 months is, even on personal consumption, as we talked about it, things are improving. People are willing to spend the money as long as they are confident of a better tomorrow. So we have to start working on that better tomorrow. It doesn't mean I'm saying that take away from what you can get today. But my sense is that there are limited options there that are available.
So within the limited kitty, you would rather that the government put more money towards infrastructure, healthcare, as opposed to an immediate short-term, medium-term consumption boost, correct?
No, I talked about that earlier. So in the short term, for the next 12 months, I would say focus on the extensions given for exports, continue for some more time. The benefit given to corporates for hiring up to 25,000 rupees salary employee, make that 50,000 rupees. The ESIC contribution, extend that further. So a lot of the current benefits, expand those. If there is still money left in the kitty, help those sectors. So continue to help MSME. That is, I think, an immediate need, and help some of the larger organized sectors which are hurting. So to me, these would be the immediate priorities for the next 12 months. I believe if they do that, they may not have a lot more to help on the personal consumption side beyond this. But this itself will continue to give us the impetus required for growth. And then they need to, in parallel, focus for the medium term, which is infrastructure, health, education, stuff like that. But all this must come with aggressive divestment. This government has the ability and the intent to do that. We need to just see the execution.
Okay, I won't speculate on divestment. We've spent too many years in this country doing that. You mentioned a bank investment company or a bank holding company. A couple of ideas keep coming back, right? Every budget, whether it's a DFI, you know, to fund infrastructure, or it's a bank holding company, you know, to take care of PSU bank ownership, or it's even a bad bank. What's the realistic expectation on any of these? And if you can go one by one and tell me, you know, whether you think they're really needed at this point in time or not.
India has this great opportunity over the next 10, 20 years to grow at 10% plus. The world is looking for an alternate to China. I don't think we can replace China, and that should not be our aim, but we can clearly become the alternate manufacturing hub that protects IPRs and others for the rest of the world. If we have to build a real economy like that, you need a very strong domestic financial services economy or sector. So you need Atmanirbhar financial services for Atmanirbhar India. That does not mean don't bring in whatever foreign capital you can. Bring that in. But know that that foreign capital is also responsible. It will move somewhere else if it needs to. So in parallel, build a very strong Indian financial services sector. Now, that's at a broad level. At the immediate level, when 70% of banking is state-owned banks, and if they are not going to extend credit, we are not going to see any great growth in the economy. So how do you get them to extend credit? One, they are saddled with bad loans. You have to take it off their books. That's where the bad bank or multiple bad banks open up. We can see today ARCs are still small in India, but are slowly helping in resolution of stressed companies. Open up these loans of bad banks to alternate investment funds and other such structures so that they can come in and professionally run it, because they are used to buying such distressed debt all over the world, many of these fund managers. So open that up. That gives some breathing space to the PSBs. You then need to capitalize them to be able to grow. Now, you can't capitalize all of them, and that's where the keep the strategic ones and divest the rest. That's where that point of view comes from. The ones then you capitalize, you better professionalize as well, because otherwise you'll be faced with the same bad debt situation 10 years down the line. And we have seen that cycle in the past. So it's not one element, and that's why you hear so many things, because it all follows one after the other. Large projects, even today, if Germany, Korea, China can have large government-owned domestic institutions, domestic financial institutions, the DFIs, I think we folded ours too prematurely and converted them into regular banks. But that's also because we needed banks 25 years ago. So the timing is good right now to create one or two large ones for infrastructure, further capitalize NABARD for agriculture and agricultural support, both rural and urban. Use SIDBI for MSME and SMEs. You have some of those entities already available, because we have to go now with all guns blazing as a financial services sector to support the real economy. Otherwise, we will grow at 6%. Hindu rate of growth used to be 3%. That will now be 6%. But we will lose that 10% opportunity.
You're suggesting that a bad bank to help public sector banks deal with their bad loans, a bank investment company to help sort of, create a second layer and ability to capitalize the good ones, and a development financial institution, are all three efforts that you would want in this budget and you expect that they would work in lockstep?
So the first and the third, yes, as far as a bank holding company is concerned, that is one structure by which then the government is one step away from direct ownership, but they can even keep their direct ownership in a few banks and in the rest divest. So that's more a question of what works for them. But the first one, the need to create those bad banks and take the bad cholesterol outside of the system of the public sector banks, and the development financial institution are both very important, because today our infrastructure projects, part of the challenges of infrastructure projects is that legal cases, getting land, getting other approvals, always ends up taking longer than required. And to get long-term debt in this country at attractive rates is very difficult. For example, I would mention one more point. As insurance companies, we have to keep 50% of our investments in government securities. I think that should be brought down to 25%. We will be forced to deploy them into long-term capital requirements. So we will become a supplier of capital for long-term infrastructure projects. So you have to think of various ways in which you can match the duration of the project with the duration of money that you hold. And that's where the DFI comes into effect. That's where insurance and pension money comes into play. But each of these need to be then aligned to achieve that end purpose.
So you don't see a challenge in capitalizing either a bad bank or several bad banks, whatever the structure is, or even a DFI. You think there's enough domestic money available, including maybe some government capital or seed capital, to be able to do this?
Yes, I think so. Because the opportunity is there. Instead, as the world sees our intent getting converted into action, you will see that capital coming in. And also, let's keep in mind, the world is flush with money. It will stay flush for the next 18 months, 2 years. But at some point of time, the pandemic, in its seriousness, is going to be behind us. And governments will start tightening their belts. Now, we can already see with China that they are sucking up a lot of this money. So either we do it as well. And of course, there are safeguards around it. So how much will you do? What kind of safeguards do you put in place? What does it do to your currency rates? You have to look at some of these things. But there are very smart people there doing that. We might as well attract some of that now because it won't exist 18 to 24 months down the line.
Okay, fair point. That pretty much covers the conversation I wanted to have with you on the budget. We have about 5-7 minutes left. I do have a couple of questions to put to you, specifically on your company and the NBFC, you know, landscape. And I'll put them to you really quickly. One thing caught my eye in your earnings release, and that is the kind of churn or attrition you've seen in your mortgage portfolio. And it just let, you know, sort of the question popped in my head, simple maybe, but this in a very low interest rate scenario, do NBFCs still have an incredible competitive edge?
You know, that's a good question. And that's why the answer to that is, what is the differentiation that an NBFC brings to a particular line of business versus a bank? If it's only going to be interest rate arbitrage, then when banks get into those lines of business, it will get really tough for an NBFC. Now, look at it this way. HDFC Limited is an NBFC, but it is the largest home financier competing with banks since inception. So it's not that you can't build that differentiation, but there are enough NBFCs that don't focus on building the differentiation, that don't focus on their customer service, they don't focus on uniqueness of their product or service. And they are the ones that will get hit because, as is obvious in the last few months, banks are not able to extend credit to most of the other lines of business. So as a result, they're going after some of the retail lines and they're able to cut rates more than most other NBFCs.
So you've had to take, or you said you will be taking competitive pricing action. So it's a race to the bottom right now.
No, not really. In our case, in none of our lines of business, are we the lowest interest rate service provider. But it does not mean that you don't stay within the range of interest rates at which a good quality customer will come to you. Otherwise, you'll get adverse selection. So when we see rates falling, we will also cut some of, or we'll also partly cut our rate. But on the other hand, there are a lot more intelligent things that you can do to ensure that your book still stays not only of good quality and reasonably growing, but profitable as well. And I can't let out all those secrets.
All right. Bad loans, GNPA or gross NPA ratio would have been 2.86. This is the pro forma numbers if the Supreme Court stay had been lifted, versus 1.34 in the preceding quarter. That's an almost doubling of bad loans. Does it get much worse from here on, Sanjeev?
Hopefully not. As long as the pandemic does not throw up any nasty surprises, I would expect the worst to be behind us. As a company, we are very driven by the numbers that we see, and that's why we are very transparent in sharing those numbers so that our investors can make their own calls. But as of now, things are looking better than what we had expected. We were very conservative early on. We cut growth. We upped our collection efforts. We gave moratoriums to customers that wanted it. The good thing that we are seeing is that other than a small segment of customers who went through a tough period, and they are the ones that are contributing to the higher losses, but many others have started coming back and paying. And new loans that we have given, so the book that didn't exist prior to COVID, that book is operating at the same quality level as the pre-COVID book, which means inherently we are still in a country where people want to pay, they are honest. Some of them have gone through a terrible time, and we will have to, we are part of the system that will have to absorb some of those losses. Like the government is taking some, the individual is taking some, the financial services system has to take the rest. But incrementally, as of now, things are looking better.
So you're peaking out at 2.83 or 3% or so, nothing beyond that?
That's what it looks like as of now.
Okay, fair enough. You know, I noticed that your consolidated assets under management or AUM levels are just about back to the December 2019 levels. You're roughly at 1.43 versus 1.45 lakh crore. From here on, what kind of growth do you intend to pursue? Because you had consciously cut back on growth and cut back on lending over the last 12 months or so. Even pre-COVID, you were cutting back on lending, if I remember correctly, the last Davos conversation we had around the same time last year. So but here on, what kind of growth do you think you might be able to chase in the next 6 to 12 months?
little early to see that right now. I think by the end of Q4, we should be in a much better position to be able to talk of growth for the next year. Right now, we're still in a situation where we are coming close to normal. As I told you, first quarter, we should be at a normalized level of volume compared to pre-COVID times. So as a guess right now, there's still too many moving parts, but hopefully by the end of Q4, we should have a better sense.
Okay. A quick last couple of questions on the regulatory framework. Since we last spoke, there have been two interesting RBI papers. One, an internal working group paper that recommended the opening up of the banking license space to large business groups. You know, if a business group like yours is interested, that would benefit you if it were to become reality. And the second is a discussion paper that the RBI put out more recently on NBFC regulation. Not too many surprises there, except that, you know, some of the things we've discussed in the past are not necessarily in the paper. So if you could share your views on both, that would be great.
So the second one, as far as the regulatory supervision side, from what I've seen of this paper, it is quite pragmatic and balanced. There are certain details on formulae based on that classification, which when it comes out, we will have a better sense. But directionally, it's the correct thing to do. Over the last decade, a large number of NBFCs today are much bigger than banks and yet were operating with very light regulatory supervision. That needs to change. However, we must also keep in mind that just putting the rules are not good enough. Somebody needs to be supervising. Otherwise, we should not have seen the blow-ups, not only in NBFCs, but even in banks that have happened in the last couple of years. So there is a responsibility to the regulator as well. And I'm sure they understand that, and the last couple of years has shown that weakness. But this additional supervision was required for the large NBFCs. I think when you're small and medium, there should be a lot more flexibility so that it allows you to grow, it allows you to be innovative. Once you come to a particular size where you become important to the larger financial system, this is something that was required to be done. As far as the first, the internal working group paper is concerned, because it's very much something work in progress, that's why I've consciously not talked about it. Let's wait for the final rules to come out. And irrespective of what Bajaj does, I am firmly of this belief that in our country, if we really have to get that 10% plus GDP growth rate, we need 2 to 3 new banks every couple of years for the next decade. And only then will we really take financial services to the masses. And we have such a good example in insurance. 2000, when insurance opened up to the private sector, the total size of the government of LIC and then of the government non-life insurers was 10,000 crores each. So it was a 20,000 crore industry. It is a 8 lakh crore industry today with over 50 companies, with significant increase in penetration and density of insurance. And we still have so much to do. We are still nowhere near the where we need to be in terms of insurance penetration. So the opportunity is still great. A lot of those licenses went to business houses. Some got into trouble. That is the nature of business. You take risk. If there is fraud, please address it separately. Otherwise, encourage businesses to invest, to grow, accept failures, clean them out fast so that businesses can reinvent themselves and move ahead. And we have seen that on the insurance side. Where on the insurance side, the regulator even allows insurance companies within the group, those that are part of a group, to lend up to 5% of the assets within the group. I don't think anybody has lent even more than 1%. And you know, this whole cry that you hear that business houses will misuse the licenses. Don't give it to the ones who you think will misuse the licenses. And do you think those guys who will misuse the licenses will misuse their own licenses? There are enough other banks for them to misuse, and there are enough examples of that. I think we have to move away from crying wolf to deciding what we need to do for this country. Let's focus on that and act on that.
Okay. So do these papers in combination change your view on whether Bajaj would be interested? I'm not asking whether you're applying for a bank license or you will apply, depending on what happens. But does it change your view on your interest in wanting to become a bank?
As far as the NBFC paper is concerned, it makes us a lot more comfortable that NBFCs like us that actually already meet most of the requirements of the new supervision, we already have those practices in place, will now be on a level playing field with many others that are not. So we get even stronger as an NBFC. As far as the bank is concerned, let the final rules come out, then we'll see.
You know, one of the things the NBFC framework has, while it doesn't impose, I think from what I understand, any substantive new capital requirements on large NBFCs like you, it also doesn't discuss any kind of liquidity backstop by the regulator. And one of the things we've discussed over the last 2 years that we've seen NBFCs in trouble, you've said that maybe the RBI should make provision for such a backstop, at least for the top 10 largest NBFCs in the country. This paper doesn't address that, does it?
Correct. So this has been more on the supervision side. The good thing is that through this pandemic, as you know, RBI opened up a direct line, liquidity line to NBFCs. This was done after nearly a decade. It was last done, I think, in January 2009, after the last big financial crisis. It shows that, at least it shows now that RBI is willing to come in and help when externalities require that. Not when an individual NBFC is failing because of a poorly executed business plan or a poor business plan, but when the system is under attack because of an external driver. So that's a good point. Now, from a general liquidity point of view, here I think what RBI should seriously look at for the large NBFCs is provide them a liquidity window for which they need some security. That's why you have SLR with banks. Today, those NBFCs like us that have a fixed deposit license anyway have some money kept aside in SLR. But if those who want to access this additional window require an SLR requirement there, if nobody accesses it, you don't lose anything. And those that put in some money into SLR and use this window are the ones that are that much more robust, creating a robust financial services system. So I hope I don't know whether we'll see that or not, but yes, that is one of the points I hope comes up at some point.
All right, Sanjeev, thank you so much for your candor. It's been great speaking with you, and I hope we are able to reconnect soon after the budget to see many of these things actually become fruition. But thank you for your time today, and thank you for speaking to Bloomberg Quint.
Thank you very much.